On July 3rd, 1916, men of the 8th North Staffordshire Regiment joined British soldiers engaged in a fierce battle around the small French village of La Boisselle. The Battle of the Somme was only 3 days old, but the Allied losses were already catastrophically high and Allied gains disappointingly low. Leading the 8th North Staffords into battle was the chairman of the Wedgwood factory, the first Lord Mayor of Stoke-on-Trent, and my great-great-uncle, Major Cecil Wedgwood. Many of the men from the Wedgwood factory had followed him to the front line. This is the story of Cecil Wedgwood and the 168 men from the Wedgwood factory that swapped a life in the potteries for a life in the trenches. At the start of the 20th century, the Wedgwood factory in Stoke-on-Trent employed around 400 people and was based by the side of the Trenton Mersey Canal here in Etruria. Josiah Wedgwood built the Etruria Works here in 1769. He also built his home here, the imposing Etruria Hall. Pottery production would continue in Etruria for almost 200 years, and in 1900, wares from the Wedgwood factory were sold all around the world. Cecil Wedgwood, the great-great-grandson of Josiah I, became a partner in the Wedgwood firm in 1884. He left to fight in the Boer War and upon his return in August 1905, became chairman of Wedgwood. At this time, the Wedgwood brand was flagging, but Cecil and his cousin Frank would revitalize the factory fortunes, returning it to its former glories around the world. The factory floors of the potteries were a long way from the battlefields in northern France. When war was declared in 1914, Major Wedgwood set out to raise the 7th and 8th North Stafford Brigade from the potters, the sagger makers, the painters, and the decorators, not just from Wedgwood, but from the other pottery factories across the area. The men from the 6 pottery towns of Stoke-on-Trent flocked to his call. In order to find out more about Major Wedgwood and his life, I've come to the town of his birth, Stoke-on-Trent. The reason I want to find out more about Major Cecil Wedgwood is that he had a remarkable reputation on the factory floor as the CEO and chairman of Wedgwood, as the first Lord Mayor of Stoke-on-Trent. But what I really want to know is why are more than 100 men left their jobs in the factory to go and fight in the Great War. I want to understand the relationship they had with their CEO and chairman, who now became their major. Really understand the sense of loyalty and duty that Major Wedgwood had towards his men, but what his men felt about him. Cecil was born on the 28th of March in 1863, the only child of Godfrey and Mary Wedgwood. His mother died following complications with the birth. His early years were spent living in the Wedgwood family at the upper house in Barlaston. When Godfrey remarried, he leased the nearby Caverswold Castle, which became the family home. Cecil spent much of his childhood here, but he also spent time away from the family home, studying at Clifton College and later at the University of Geneva. Cecil's sister Mary was born in 1880, and in 1885 he met his half-sister's governess, Lucy Gibson. Cecil fell in love and they were married in 1888. This was the home, Cecil Wedgwood. He grew up here. But during the course of his life, he often found a way back here. So obviously had a significant importance in his life. If you look around, I'm starting to get an idea why it was. He spent his time in the factory, which must have been incredibly difficult in the circumstances in which he was there. It was just a very, very different place from the peace and tranquility here. And then I sort of contrast it, what it must have been like for him in serving both the Boer War and the Great War. The complete contrast to the sanctuary and peace here. I'm starting to think maybe that's why this was a really important place. This was his sanctuary. This is where he found a bit of peace.
Cecil started work at the Utrero factory in 1882. Choosing to return to the factory rather than studying at Cambridge, when ill health forced his father, Godfrey, to retire in 1891, Cecil and his cousins, Lawrence and Francis, became partners.
Here at the Wedgwood Museum, the archives contain a wealth of information from Cecil's time at the factory. Handwritten notes, experiments of different ware, his thoughts and feelings from his time all stored in this wonderful testament to British industrialism.
I've come to meet museum curator Lucy Lead.
Lucy, thank you very much for taking the time to talk with me today. What I'm trying to learn is, what was the factory like when Cecil joined, and what led him to actually join the business?
Wedgwood was going through quite a difficult period at the end of the 19th century, and by the time Cecil gets to the point where he's leaving university in 1884, he writes to his stepmother and sort of says how much he wants to come and join the factory. I think he's arguably perhaps one of the first Wedgwood family members since Josiah to be really willing to get his hands dirty and get involved in the family business. But he has a real passion. He goes around, he learns the techniques, he knows people on the factory floor, he knows what the market is, and he plays a really important part in helping to define what Wedgwood is in the late 19th, early 20th century, put Wedgwood back on the map in sort of terms of artistic talent, and then move the brand forward into the early 20th century.
What was his relationship like with the people actually on the factory floor during this time?
Cecil sort of joined up to go fight in the Boer War, which meant he was out of the factory for a number of years, sort of 1900, about 1902. When he returns to Utrecht, there's a huge party, a huge celebration, the fact that he's coming back. I mean, there are banners out, all the employees turn out to welcome Cecil back to the company. So there's a definite sense he was missed during that time, and people were glad to see him back here.
Could you give me an idea what type of leader he might have been?
I think he was very much a leader by example. He knew what was wanted. He was prepared to work, prepared to make the factory that, you know, his great-great-great-grandfather had set up so many hundreds of years ago would continue to have a future and thrive. So he was prepared to sort of put the effort in and work to ensure that the Wedgwood name, the Wedgwood brand, would continue into the future.
Did Lucy Wedgwood share this same sense of duty that Cecil might have had?
I think so, definitely. You see her getting increasingly involved in various projects to improve the life of many of the children and women in the city of Stoke-on-Trent, and that role only increases as she becomes the mayoress as well. She takes a really important role in raising money for charitable foundations in the city. She's quite an important character.
And this is quite significant when war does break out and Cecil does leave and the men from the factory floor leave, because I imagine that she had to play a fairly strong leadership role to sort of fill those shoes to some degree.
Yes, you do get the sense of she has to do it. I mean, I think she's glad to do it. It's a part of her duty.
And as the Great War broke out and Cecil goes about raising the 7th and 8th North Stafford regiments, what was the reaction on the factory floor and the people who worked with him?
I think a lot of people shared his sense of duty to go away to fight as well. I think by November 1914, already 54 members of staff had signed up to go away to fight. He definitely leads by example. Whether Wedgwood employees follow him into the North Staffordshire battalions or they go further afield, we see a split between those.
There was a substantial amount of men that left to fight with Cecil Wedgwood. What kind of impact did that have on the company?
Well, it was huge. You see men from all departments in the company going away to fight, everything from the throwers to the coopers to the packers, even members of the museum department go away and fight. So you have men leaving from all over the company.
Lucy, what can you tell me about some of the other men that went to fight with the Cecil?
Of the 168 men that went to go to fight during the First World War, these men ended across all sort of arenas of war during the First World War. Perhaps one of the most touching stories is that of Harold Poynton, who worked as a printer at Wedgwood. So Cecil would have known him in 1914. And he joins up with Cecil Wedgwood to become his batman. So he's responsible for helping look after Wedgwood. And there are some charming references to Poynton in Cecil's letters. Stuff like he says quite jokingly that Cecil's Poynton's getting better at making his coffee, or, you know, Poynton's been sent off to do his laundry. And it's really quite touching stories about how this man is looking after him. Another interesting character is a Private H.E. Beeston. He goes away to go fight in Gallipoli. He receives quite severe wounds as a result of the fight, and he's buried at sea in 1915 as he's coming out of Gallipoli. There are numerous stories that we can tell, and then we have stories of people that came back as well, you know, of the lives they made afterwards. We have a wonderful document in the archive which sort of tells you all the professions of the men that were going to fight and what happened to them. But occasionally you'll see the odd reference after their name, such as lost a leg during the war. And you get this sense that, yes, unfortunately they might have suffered a disability almost, but a place was still for them at Wedgwood if they chose to come back to work.
Pottery firms such as Wedgwood dominated the landscape and the lives of people across the towns of North Staffordshire at the start of the 20th century. As head of the Wedgwood firm, Cecil was an important figure in North Staffordshire's civil and business life. The six pottery towns all had their own separate identities, but many local people, including Cecil, strongly believed that united together, the six towns would be stronger. And so in 1910, the six towns became the county borough of Stoke-on-Trent. Later, it would become the city of Stoke-on-Trent. This federation of six towns would need a mayor. Historian Fred Hughes has written extensively about this critical time in the history of Stoke-on-Trent.
The inauguration of the new civic administration happened on the 31st of March 1910. That's when Stoke-on-Trent became the borough of Stoke-on-Trent. Now, in those days, Tom, it was a matter of electing first off. The first job that they had was to elect the mayor. Cecil Wedgwood became the first mayor of the borough of Stoke-on-Trent. Unlike today, the mayor was virtually everything. The leader of the new council, the person who helped to make legislation. He wasn't just the chairman. And he understood this. And he wrote to his mother to say, "I really feel so emotional about this. It really does mean something rather special."
But why do you think men flocked towards Cecil Wedgwood when he went about raising the 7th and 8th Battalion?
Cecil was already acknowledged as a leader of men. He was an adventurer, and he was that classic looking adventurer. I mean, they said that he looked like a Viking warrior in any case, and so he did. There's some wonderful photographs of him at that particular period. He turned to his workforce, and as all manufacturers did, and said, "Look, we've got a battalion to raise. We've got an input to make. We want to protect our lives, our citizens of the United of England and Wales and Scotland and Ireland. So we must put our weight behind this. There's been a call for it. I'm going to lead you. Will you come with me?" And there appeared to be no hesitation. There is massive evidence in the Wedgwood Museum, as you will well know, in the form of letters that were written back. The men who served under Cecil Wedgwood were so patriotic and so genuinely enthralled by him and respected him to that degree that they saw him. And as all men on a battlefield, they see that leader as the person who's going to save them, as well as protect them and lead them into glory.
How important was Cecil Wedgwood to the history of Stoke-on-Trent?
He achieved much. He satisfied himself. he satisfied his family. I think he was the great leader of Federation. I think he changed that. But he made it happen at a time which was critical, which was a time of national change in politics, national change in direction, national change in culture and in business. And I think right at the beginning, right at that point, I think he achieved greatness.
As well as being mayor of Stoke-on-Trent and chairman of a major international manufacturer, Cecil had a distinguished military career. In 1899, Cecil left England to fight in the Boer War. He fought with the 4th North Staffords, and in September 1900 was commissioned to the rank of major. Whilst fighting in South Africa, he was awarded the Distinguished Service Order, which was presented to him by Edward VII. When the Great War broke out in 1914, Cecil was 51. He was commissioned as a major in Kitchener's army and set to work raising a battalion amongst local men. The history of the North Staffordshire Regiment is preserved at the Staffordshire Regimental Museum in Lichfield.
Hi, Jim.
Hi, welcome.
Pleasure to meet you.
And you.
Can you tell me a little bit about the Staffordshire Regiment Museum?
Yes, we've been on this site since 1961. It's got a collection of all the history of both the North Staffordshire Regiment and the South Staffordshire Regiment. And then since 1959, when they merged, the Staffords, and it will continue with the Mercian Regiment today.
In your experience, what do you think Cecil's motivation was to go and fight? He was 51, so he's quite old. What drove him to raise the regiment's action and go and fight?
At 51, clearly he was a middle-aged man, some might, for the standards of the day, possibly old. Going out and fighting in the trenches, in November, December, January, February, is going to be taxing for a man of his age. So my guess is it was pure duty. He had been Lord Mayor of Stoke-on-Trent. He was running the Wedgwood Company, so he was clearly a responsible individual.
And in that time, what sort of challenges would he had faced in raising the battalions?
I think, I was stunned. He raised the 7th Battalion, the North Staffordshire Regiment, in a few days. And then equally, it was about 10 days to raise a 2nd Battalion. Now, obviously there was massive enthusiasm for people joining, but then there's the organisational difficulties. And if you read the history of the 8th North, you get the impression that they weren't paid for a few weeks. The War Office couldn't cope with the influx. And we know they went to Whittington Barracks, which is just behind us here. And again, they have an establishment, with officers and NCOs to run platoons and sections. And clearly they were overwhelmed with hundreds of new recruits. And they were obviously struggling for a while. And they relied on older officers and NCOs to come back and help out, basically for nothing.
There's a fantastic archive at the museum, dating back to the Napoleonic Wars. But we've come to find out more about Major Wedgwood and his men. And this is documented in the book, The History of the 8th North Staffordshire Regiment.
Wow, that is quite the uniform. Can you tell me why you dressed like that?
I'm one of the regiment's volunteers, educational volunteers here at the Staffordshire Regiment Museum. And effectively what we do is we go around and we do educational tours for schools and we take them around the trench and illustrate in uniform all the facts and interesting features about the World War I trench.
Fantastic. So what would this uniform, what time period would this uniform?
This is 1916, and yes. It's actually a North Staffordshire 1st Regiment uniform with the webbing equipment and helmet and gas mask as well. So yeah, it's everything to do with the North Staffordshire 1st Regiment.
Rob, does this book give any insight into the character of Major Wedgwood?
Yes. Here we have a quote. Although he was offered the command of other battalions on at least two occasions, he preferred the association of the Staffordshire men and accepted the lower rank for this purpose. From now, he played a most important part in the affairs of the battalion, which was part of his very existence. Everything that a father might have done for his children was done by the major for the men of the 8th Battalion. He was unceasingly watchful of their comfort and welfare, even at the expense of his own.
So this really gives some insight in the loyalty that he had
towards his troops. Do you think that was probably unusual for that time?
We brought up on the perception that the generals and higher staff were further back from the line and didn't really care about, you know, lions led by donkeys. But this is conveying a totally different message here. Here we're hearing that he, you know, it's his own expense, he's making sure that the men are comfortable. That could be the way they're billeted, the way they're fed. That's what I'm reading that as. And in my research, it does seem to imply that, yes.
Cecil was able to raise these battalions very fast. What does that say about him as a man?
To me, it conveys he was a man of aspiration, in the sense that obviously to raise a battalion in such a short time, you know, you must have had a great sense of purpose, duty, honour, a man to follow. It obviously is depicting something that's impressive.
This has been really emotional and it's given me a much clearer insight into who Major Wedgwood was as a man. I always knew the sense of duty that he had. I mean, it was very evident in how he served in the company, but to hear how his men felt about him as a leader, it's given me a much clearer insight. And I think it's really important now to go to France and to learn about his experiences at Lavoisier. There's no doubting just how much Major Wedgwood cared about his men and their well-being. They were quite often referred to as Major Wedgwood's pets. In winter 1915, he wrote home to his wife, "Last night, when we left the trenches, the water was coming into the dugouts and standing everywhere. The whole place is a swamp in winter. The trenches were collapsing everywhere, and the men were buried by the trench slides falling in on them. They were soaked and had a very cold, uncomfortable night. Despite this, the men are splendid. They live in perpetual discomfort and considerable danger, as casualties show, but they never grumble and are cheerful and patient." A 100 years ago, thousands of British men made the journey over the Channel to northern France to fight on the Western Front. Major Wedgwood and the North Staffords traveled by boat on Saturday the 17th of July 1915, landing in France the following day. I've come north from Paris to Albert to find out more about their experiences.
In Albert, the Somme Museum can be found in underground tunnels beneath the town that were used by the troops during the Great War.
Alan, can you tell us a little bit about the museum and the significance of being here in Albert?
Yeah, well, as you can see, this museum is situated in an underground tunnel, which is there already for about 700 or 800 years. There's another here in Albert only, another 5 or 6 tunnel systems like this. And it was used for the local population to hide when there were attacks.
Yes.
During the Middle Ages, for example, notably against the Spanish. But again, during the First World War, it was used for a soldier reserve, ammunition storage.
And it's remarkable because this museum captures what it must have been like in the trenches. What do you think that experience was for the troops, especially in some of the trenches that were really, you know, tough battles we've been fought in, just around Lavoisier?
Yeah, well, I think in the beginning everybody was a little bit pushed to go to war.
Yes.
And everybody saw it a little bit also as an adventure. But finally, when they really arrived in the front line, it was horrific. The reality was a little bit different than I was thinking. It was like we were talking about Lavoisier, where your granduncle was.
Yes.
Who died over there. Yeah, the reality was very, very different.
What would Lavoisier be like?
Lavoisier at that time, July, was totally flattened. There was nothing left. It was so shelled, so heavily shelled. All the houses were gone. It was totally, totally obliterated, really obliterated. The Germans over there in the village, they dug huge dugouts, communication systems, trench lines. The Germans, they were underground. because they had to, because above ground there was nothing left, absolutely nothing.
In June 1916, the 8th North Staffords marched to Auber to prepare for the push. The push, as they nicknamed it, would be the Battle of the Somme. The battalion formed part of the 57th Infantry Brigade, which in turn was part of the 19th Division. The 19th Division would be known as the Butterfly Division because of their frequent flying visits to many parts of the Western Front. If the fighting was fierce and called for first-class fighting troops, the 19th Division would be called for.
Life on the Western Front during the First Great War was tough for the North Staffords. I've come to the Museum of the Great War in Perron to find out more.
What would the experience of the soldiers been like at the beginning of the Battle of the Somme?
So the Battle of the Somme is the symbol of the Great War. It represents the discrepancy between the determination of men who did not have the experience to fight in a modern war and this very industrial modern killing that had developed over the last 50 years. And the Somme, still today, represents the sacrifice of an entire generation that went off to war to defend, in essence, Britishness.
Cecil Wedgwood fought along men from his factory firm. How important was this in the Great War, men fighting with people from their community or men that they knew?
Certainly in the British Army, at first, the idea was to try and keep the men who knew each other together. The most famous units are the PALS battalions of volunteers who all volunteered together from a for example, a company or club, a sports club, or even from the same street neighborhood, and they would go off to war together. That would create a very strong sense of belonging and a sense of pride where everybody could identify individually and collectively. Now, it seems to me that in Cecil's case, there was also the importance of showing that one's place in society in back home meant that it was not only honors but also a duty, and that it was his duty to lead his men on the battlefield as he had led them in the economic field. At the age of 53, Cecil could have avoided going to war, as indeed many men did, because the age limit was 46 even at the end of the war. So all soldiers who died above that age were all volunteers and decided to go and serve for personal reasons and also for to show an example for the others.
And I think you're right, it's this sense of duty, something a little bit bigger than himself. And the image I always have of my great-great-uncle is just of that. You know, he was a person that would put community, his men, the people on the factory floor, probably above himself. So that does answer a very important question for me. Thank you.
On the morning of the 1st of July, the 8th North Staffords, under the command of Major Wedgwood, marched down this road as part of the 19th Division. They would be held in reserve as the 34th Division attacked Le Boiselle on the opening day of the Battle of the Somme. Le Boiselle had been fought over since 1914 and was of extreme strategic importance for both the Germans and the Allied armies. However, the trenches around Le Boiselle were infamous in the British Army as being among the worst on the Western Front. Thousands of men crowded into the trenches around here, preparing themselves for the push. But before any attack took place, the Allied forces had a huge surprise in store for the German soldiers, based just 1 kilometer away from here.
Wow.
And there we have it.
Wow.
The famous mine of Lop-de-Gar.
Wow. The size of it is just remarkable.
Rob, could you tell me a little bit about the crater?
Well, this crater, first of all, is so important now because it's one of the most important sites visited on the Somme.
Yeah.
And this is looked after by the Friends of Lochnagar under the direction of a guy called Richard Dunning, who bought this for an undisclosed price. He knew the importance of this mine. This mine is very important for us for the Battle of the Somme, and it's one of 19 that were detonated. This particular mine is said to be one of the biggest on the Western Front, and also the loudest explosion that was known until this time in history.
Until you come here and see it, the enormity of this crater is, it's remarkable. What quantity of explosives would it have taken to create this?
Well, here we've got 24 ton of high explosive, or 90,000 pounds. That's going to take three large lorries to bring that here. But this has got to come through a tunnel, 750 metres dug behind me, directly underneath our line, out into no man's land, underneath the Germans, with a specialist engineer company who's going to build a room, they say, the size of a pitch gallery. And by shaping the roof of the pitch gallery, the mine, they can tell you how deep this hole will be, how high this bank around us will be.
So my great-great-uncle was fighting not far from here, and I'm trying to envision what life might have been like for him and the British soldiers as the battle broke out.
Well, if you can imagine, your great-uncle, Cecil Wedgwood, with his 8th Battalion of the North Staffordshire Regiment, and they're here in reserve, ready to go forward. We've already had the first waves probably have gone over the top. These mines we just mentioned were so loud they were heard in London. How could we possibly prepare our men in these trenches for this out of sound? Some of these men had heard mines going off before. They'd heard German mines go off. They'd heard British mines off. The majority of them, of course, wouldn't have had that experience. But had in heard that go off and seen the barrage going in, and all the talks that had been given before this battle with the crescendo of artillery that was massed here on the battlefield, the largest barrages we'd ever seen, there would have been a great confidence amongst these men that they can go forward and do what they're going to do.
In Major Cecil Wedgwood's case, he was trying to counter a false order to retreat. How do you think that situation might have come about?
The German soldiers here, many of them, of course, and we know well, had worked on cruise ships around the world. They'd worked in restaurants around the world. These German soldiers wanted to know who was opposite them. So even in the lean time on the battlefields, the Germans quite often in the evening would call across the battlefield, because if they could get a British soldier to talk back, they could instantly recognise, this is a man from the north of England, this is a Geordie, listen to this. And then 3 days later, the soldiers here from the south of England. 4 weeks later, the Scots regiments turned up. They always wanted to know, and they would call across the battlefield. And it's well known that on the battlefields of the Somme on several occasions, and even earlier battles and later battles, the Germans, with good English accents, would shout out, retreat, retreat, withdraw, and hopefully cause confusion amongst the men, and the men would come back.
From the Wedgwood family's point of view, you know, we can sometimes focus on just the loss. You know, why Cecil Wedgwood risked leaving his role as chairman and CEO of the company, why he took 168 men with him to fight here. But I now understand it really wasn't a loss, it was a massive gain. And the courage of all the men who came out here and put their hearts on the line to fight an incredibly bloody and brutal battle. As you said, they've reshaped the world today. And standing here, I just feel immense amount of gratitude to those men and to my great-great-uncle for volunteering to come and fight in this battle. Immense gratitude. And thank you very much, Rod. It is a pleasure to be here and super to meet you.
To Major Cecil Wedgwood and each man remembered.
Thank you. It's hard to imagine the horror of the sight that greeted the North Staffords in the 19th Division as they were called up from the reserve to fight at Lebazel. The 34th Division had lost over 6,000 men on the first day of the Somme, and many of their bodies still lay on the shell-scarred battlefield. The trenches were filled with the dead, the dying, and the wounded from previous attempts to take the village. The bombs dropping on the shattered village illuminated the sky around them, and the noise of the intense shelling echoed throughout the trenches. The order to attack came at 3:15 a.m. on the morning of the 3rd of July. The 57th and 58th Division attacked and at once encountered fierce German opposition,
they began to make headway, advancing some 400 yards, and eventually took the village of Lubazel. Rockets were launched to indicate the village had fallen. As this happened, mortars and howitzers began to rain down on the troops. The counterattack had started. Confused men heard a cry to retire, and at this moment, hearing an unauthorized order, Major Wedgwood leapt onto the parapet of the trench, ordering his men to ignore the retreat. "Forward, North Staffords," was his cry. And then there was a shot.
He took his place at the head of the battalion, and he led us into action like a Briton. He kept very cool, and ordered his men to keep cool also. Although the machine guns were rattling with fire and the shells were bursting with deafening sounds. But although for the heavy fire, he kept guiding and command of his gallant men until first one fell, then another, and they were falling all around us. Till at last I saw our grand Major Wedgwood fall, in which he was shot through the neck by a machine gun in which they had turned on us from their second line of trenches before they retired. He tried hard to regain consciousness, but he failed. His wound too severe, and he soon passed away. I can safely say that our late Major Wedgwood was a true, brave, and British hero up to his last hour, and he died like a hero on the battlefield of glory and honour. And I hereby send Mrs. Wedgwood and family my deepest thought and sympathy, as I fought close by him and was near him when I saw him pass away. Private A.E. Simpson.
Major Cecil Wedgwood was shot through the neck and he died almost instantly. He fell just yards from here, the memorial to the 19th Division at Lubazel. Major Wedgwood had led his men from the factory floor to war, but he would not be returning with them. His men erected a wooden cross on the spot where he fell. On it, they wrote, "One of England's best." Major Wedgwood died instantly and was carried from the battlefield by stretcher-bearer Private Proctor. He's buried here at the Balpone Post Military Cemetery, about a mile from Lubazel. Many members of the 8th North Staffords wrote to Mrs. Wedgwood to express their sympathy and to share memories of Major Wedgwood. This is a letter written by Private May. "Madam, recently an argument arose to where your dear husband Major Cecil Wedgwood was buried. Some said they'd been taken to England, and I said no, because I'd seen his grave a short time before. So I said I'd take you there this afternoon and show you where he's buried. So we went to a small cemetery between Albert and Lubazel. They saw for themselves, and on the headpiece it said, 'One of England's best.' And those are the truest words ever spoken. He was the best. So we scraped the snow off the grave and gathered some white stones and placed it around it. It was the best that we could do. There was nothing else to put on, and there was not one dry eye in the crowd. One of Major Wedgwood's pets, that's what they called us." Along this journey, learning about Cecil Wedgwood, I've been constantly asking myself, what was his motivation for going to this war? Why? He was quite old. He had proven himself as a good commander in previous war. He'd proven himself as a good business leader. He'd proven himself as a good public servant. So why now would he risk it all? And I know the answer to that now. He was a man that was driven by a sense of duty, by putting people and community above himself, by putting his men above himself. He was incredibly selfless. And I now understand why his men said Cecil was one of England's best. But so are they all.